Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Sarah Turner, and I'm the Deputy Director for Research at the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. Welcome to today's event, which is part of Art Criticism and the Pandemic Part 2, organised in collaboration with Chris McCormack, Associate Editor at Art Monthly. At the start of proceedings, I want to thank Chris and acknowledge his work in conceptualising and crafting these events and for his ongoing collaboration with the Paul Mellon Centre. Art and the Pandemic Part 2 will unfold over 2 days, and today we're considering the idea of safer spaces, and tomorrow we will ponder wearing out. With a range of art critics, artists, activists, art historians, poets and writers, who will discuss the implications of the current conditions of a global pandemic for their work and the broader field of art criticism and writing, and more broadly, writing on art and culture. Collectively, these two panels will continue and reshape the discussions had at the Art Criticism and the Pandemic events organised by Chris with the Paul Mellon Centre in July 2020, which considered how the structures of a globalised art world have been interrupted or changed, and whether in the context of renewed activism, the art world is addressing problems of inequity and injustice in its own order. These ideas remain just as urgent, if not more so, as the art world renegotiates the legacies and ramifications of making, thinking, and writing about art and culture in the context of a global pandemic. These events over the next 2 days will be spaces for testing out ideas rather than final words. And there will also be space for questions and discussions punctuating the talks. The talks will be recorded and hosted on the Paul Mellon Centre's website, where you can also find out more about our work as a research centre and as an educational charity. Before handing over to Chris to introduce our panel today, I just want to quickly run through a bit of housekeeping for our online webinars. You'll see that each talk will last about 10 minutes, and after every second talk, there'll be a Q&A where we'll invite you to ask questions. The event has closed live captioning, and if you want to see that, you click on the CC icon on your webinar control panel to see those captions. Use the Q&A box to ask the panel questions, and the moderators will read those out for the panelists to answer. And we really encourage you to get involved and be part of this conversation. And you can also use the chat box to make comments or to let us know if you're experiencing any technical difficulties, and the team at the PMC will get back to you. The session will be recorded, and we ask you not to take photos during it. And of course, any offensive behaviour will not be tolerated, and the attendees can be removed from the webinar by the host. I'll hand over to Chris now to say more about the theme of today's panel and to introduce our speakers.
Many thanks, Sarah. I'll try and keep this as brief as possible. But firstly, I'd like to thank the Paul Mellon Centre and Sarah Teller for bringing this programme together and to extend last year's talks and to reflect upon some of the urgent subjects raised through the pandemic. I'd also like to thank Shauna Blanchfield for all her hard work behind the scenes too. The impetus for this talk came from an increasing awareness of how the tension between individual body control and collective health security during this current disruption of the pandemic is tightly framed across the globe, and how it constricts a timeline of conflicting modernities and access to vaccination. Further, considering the global as one continually remade by colonial forces and extraction, how might histories of pandemics chart our understanding of the way statecraft narratives that regulate access to marriage, reproductive rights, and legal gender have and continue to regulate the infected, the sick, or dangerous body through border control? Today's speakers will reflect on this subject of sovereignty from Uganda, Ireland and Northern Ireland, and Thailand, to articulate emergent patterns of commonalities and difference, and of inclusion and exclusion. This leads me to welcome today's panel. It is truly an honor to have you here, and genuinely thank you for taking the time to contribute to this session. So I'll introduce each of the speakers today. And today we are joined by Dr. Shreya Chatterjee, who is a contributing editor for the open access peer-reviewed British art journals co-published by the Paul Mellon Centre and the Yale Centre for British Art. She is currently a Swiss National Science Foundation Fellow at the Institute for Experimental Design and Media at the FHNW at Basel, and Associate Scholar at the Max Planck Art History Institute. Shreya holds a PhD from Princeton University and was awarded the Charlotte Elizabeth Proctor Honorific Fellowship in 2019. Shreya specializes in the political ecologies of art and design in the 19th and 20th centuries, with a particular focus on transnational environmental histories, the histories of art and science, and the relationships between climate and race. Shreya is currently leading the international digital project, Visualizing the Virus, and which she will discuss today. Dr. Isabel Harbison is an Irish art historian and critic and lecturer in critical studies in the art department at Goldsmiths London. Her research interests lie at the intersections of art, politics, and media, and writes regularly about artists working performance and moving image. Her current academic research focuses on the history of artists' moving image in Northern Ireland from 1968 to present day in relation to political and media history. Her talk will look at three feminist films from this territory made during the 1980s and is concerned with colonialism, civil rights, reproductive rights, and negotiated citizenry. Dr. Stella Nyanzi is a multiple award-winning medical anthropologist with specialization in sexual and reproductive health, sexual rights, and human sexualities in Uganda and the Gambia. She self-identifies as a radical queer feminist scholar, social justice activist, human rights defender, non-violent protester, poet, Facebooker, opposition politician belonging to the Forum for Democratic Change, former aspirant for the Kampala Woman MP from 2020 to 2021, an ex-prisoner from Luzira Women's Maximum Security Prison, and mother of three teenagers. She obtained her doctoral degree from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine in 2009, a Master of Science degree in the Medical Anthropology from University College London in 1999, and a Bachelor of Arts in Mass Communication and Literature from Makerere University in 1997. Finally, Ariane Sutterbong is an independent curator and writer based in Bangkok, Thailand. She works closely with both Thai and international artists to pick apart dominant narratives and framings and collectively seeks to redefine them. Together with Laura Van Meteren and Bart Wissink, she's co-organizing the Inappropriate Book Club as part of the Bangkok Biennial. She is co-editor of Common Descent, Texts and Art and Politics in the Age of Radical Appropriation, and holds an MA in Art and Politics from Goldsmiths University of London. The order of today's talk will be Stella, followed by Shreya, after which we will have a discussion of their papers. We will then hear from Isabel and Ariane before opening to further discussion. I urge audience members to add questions as we go. As Sarah mentioned, we aim for the talks to be conversational and open for debate. If I could kindly ask Stella to start her presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Chris. I will share my screen and then start the presentation. Can everybody see? Have you received the screen?
Yes, we can see it.
Yes, we can see.
Right, so I'm grateful to Chris McCormack of Art Monthly for inviting me to participate in the Paul Mellon Center's panel on paper spaces under the second part of the series entitled Art Criticism and the Pandemic. I will focus on the ambivalence of borders as underscored by COVID-19 and the narratives and praxis of statecraft unraveled in Uganda, but Africa more widely in attempt to curb transmission of the virus. The notion of safety deployed in the construction of safer spaces relies heavily on boundaries, borders, fences, gates, and perimeter walls made of bricks, if one is Donald Trump. Given that COVID-19 is largely airborne in transmission, one wonders how high the walls of the boundaries between safety and risk would have to be built. Drawing from globalizing directives from the World Health Organization, national health and security relied on closing down, locking up, and shutting down each country's borders. Inflows and outflows of human traffic out of into and within borders was suspended, securitized, criminalized, even penalized and pathologized. Immediate arrivals, especially at airports, were arrested, quarantined, sometimes for up to 14 days, tested and observed. They were potentially dangerous bodies. For us in Africa and other territories with a colonial history, our national lockdown programs relied on national borders. That's the importance of my first map. A map, a piece of art we have inherited from our colonizers, delineating our national borders. I'm from Uganda. At the time of invitation, I was an exile in Kenya. And now at the time of presentation, hardly a month, Chris, huh? I'm now back in my country because Kenya is undergoing a second lockdown. But our programs relied on national borders created during colonialism, when our colonizers, including Britain, France, Germany, Portugal, and Spain, greedily partook in the traumatic scramble and partition of Africa. Our geographical borders, beautifully drawn in the cartography or map of Africa, are a colonial creation. My passport as a Ugandan is a colonial legacy. And indeed, our national and African continent borders are part of our colonial heritage. They are a reminder that we were once colonized, even in this decolonial moment, and our coloniality, our history of being colonized peoples, was reinforced when national borders became crucial to ascertaining safety of countries. This colonial imprint is deeply embellished onto our identity as members of the Commonwealth, former colonies of Britain, as Africans, running deep to influence our politics, our economics, cultures, languages. I speak English, and our allegiances even today in the COVID-19 programs that we have as nations. So drawing from my biography during the COVID-19 lockdown in Uganda, I enter this space as an artist, as an activist, who draws on not fine art per se, but on poetry and writing genres in creative writing and fiction. One of the five times I was arrested in 2020 was because I was allegedly caught disrespecting the borders and the national border closures. I was charged with violating COVID-19 guidelines by participating in an activity likely to spread COVID-19 through using porous Sofia borders to cross from Kenya into Uganda. To highlight the duplicity, hypocrisy, and double standards of the joint state
Sorry, Dara, I believe Stella might have paused for one moment. Just give us a minute and I'm sure she'll be back. Thank you.
Hi, have I disappeared?
You have, but you've come back. Thank you, Stella.
Sorry about that. I'm in Africa and in my country, there's a severe monitoring of what we do on the internet, but I'll keep going. So just to highlight the duplicity, hypocrisy, and double standards of the security agents, in the time I was arrested, King Ronald Mutebi, that is the king of my kingdom, his visit across the same national borders was widely publicized and published in the social and public news media. Further heightening, so I should have a picture which is not coming on, but I'll keep going. I should have a picture coming up. Sorry about this. Yes, that is King Ronald Mutebi of my kingdom in Uganda, speaking with the president of Kenya. So he crossed the national borders during the national lockdown related to COVID-19. He was not arrested. He was hailed for doing important foreign policy and relations work. I was arrested. Further heightening the duplicitousness and duplicity distinguishing of human bodies engaged in cross-border travel during the pandemic, President Yoweri Museveni, the president of my country, was also widely publicized traveling to Tanzania, another country neighboring us, to meet the late deceased President John Pombe Magufuli, who's rumored to have died with COVID-19. His utter denialism of COVID-19 science, because he asserted it was colonizing, imperialistic, and globalizing, was at its peak, illustrated by the tension in the contrast between the President Museveni's convoy, all of them are wearing masks. Those are the ones on the right, on the left-hand side, while the defiant lack of protective masks of his counterpart, President Magufuli, and his convoy speaks to this interesting contrast. So while Yoweri Museveni again was hailed for traveling across borders during the COVID lockdown to a country where the president had not issued any lockdown measures, any COVID-19 restrictions for his country folk, he was not arrested. The king of Buganda was not arrested. I, a poor woman, supposedly and allegedly found across the borders using porous borders, was arrested, charged, and I'm facing particular cases in court right now. It is apparent from this biographical and political anecdote that the profiling of mobile bodies as dangerous bodies with real potential to be vectors of COVID-19 is not applied uniformly to all human bodies. Men of power and authority, in this case a president and a king, somehow had immunity, which obviously excluded my kind. Viruses do not respect bodies. I now turn to the unforeseen consequences of statecraft during COVID-19, creating alternating, contradictory, compelling, competing, and even exclusionary modernities. The progressive, linear, and globalizing sustainable development goal of achieving universal health was the main driver of almost all our national policies and programs designed and deployed in response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Intra-country mobility was suspended in Uganda through the issuance of strict prohibitions of public and private transport for all peoples inside the country. The only exceptions or allowances were provided to essential workers whose status was confirmed through the issuance of unique COVID-19 travel permits, which recalled another colonial legacy of the apartheid system's dome pass issued to Black racial minors during apartheid in South Africa. Again, we see a creation of two artificially bounded categories of supposedly mobile, safer, essential workers and the immobile, non-essential other. This operation had dire consequences upon individuals and groups that routinely needed the travel for other health services, including dialysis, antiretroviral therapies for HIV/AIDS, women who had to attend antenatal care for pregnant mothers, and the safe delivery of babies. To other illnesses. Moreover, the prohibition of mobility was classist and exclusionary because it penalized and endangered people who traveled daily to make meager earnings from wage labor in the informal sector. For many of these Ugandans who live a hand-to-mouth existence, the safe measures necessary to achieve right to health and freedom from COVID-19 directly exposed them to alternative pandemics, namely the hunger pandemic arising from the poverty pandemic. I just shared a slide. This the disappeared and it is drawn from my first arrest in 2020. Which was effected at a peaceful demonstration against the delayed and failed distribution of food relief packages to vulnerable people. A new category of dangerous people, endangered people, vulnerable people created when mobility to earn subsistence income was prohibited. Income poverty was exacerbated by COVID-19 curfew, which led to closure of the night economy. And we can talk a bit about the night economy and how borders and boundaries around time impacted and created new forms and alternating notions of safety and risk. With rising unemployment, poverty and lack, the assumed safety of home was heavily eroded as idle violent men began or scaled up domestic violence and gender-based violence. As I use my last few minutes to introduce what I want to say, I guess is I have spoken as an activist thinking around the porosity of assumed fixed borders in COVID-19. I think that the national measures that we had relied heavily upon a conceptualization of safety within borders that were non-porous. As I have highlighted from my biography, but also the political situation in Uganda, many times these borders were proved to be false and non-imagined inadvertent other borders was created around social categories. What is the role of art and artists in this small presentation I've made? And I want to say that as an activist, it would have been good if we'd had artists utilizing creative non-violent means to speak truth to power. Of course, in my case as an activist, it became dangerous because COVID-19 was utilized and deployed heavily to criminalize any forms of contestation and questioning of the uniform blanket homogeneous directives that were given to the state. It would have been wonderful if we'd had artists on board countering and amplifying and visibilizing the issues, especially around iniquity and the vagaries and obscenity and oppressiveness and recreation of new inequalities created by the COVID-19 borders around space, around safety, and around time. And so I look forward to an interesting discussion, but also to learn lessons that I can take away that perhaps we can employ also in my current context. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stella, that was great. We'll come back to some of the issues that you've raised in that paper, but we'll move on now to Shreya and then we'll have a discussion. So Shreya, could you share your screen and start your presentation?
Yeah, great, thank you so much, Chris. And thank you, Stella, as well. I'll share my screen and just a second. Do you all see my screen?
Yes, this is coming true.
Yep, okay, great. So I wanna just thank Chris for the introduction and both of you, Sarah and Chris, for making these spaces available for discussion and to have these conversations, I think is really important. So I'm going to present an ongoing digital humanities project here today. And the aim of presenting the project really is to start a conversation so we can think together about the global as one continually remade by colonial forces and extraction, about nationalisms, visualizing invisibility, as well as modes of care. I also want to say before we start that even though things have started to seem optimistic in the UK with the lockdown lifting, vaccinations more or less on track, the situation in India and elsewhere in Brazil, for example, is a really stark reminder that this is still very much an ongoing crisis and it's really far from being over. And so I want to be mindful of this and how vulnerable many of us are feeling at the moment with devastating news pouring in from friends, family, and colleagues. So visualizing the virus is an interdisciplinary cultural project, and the final outcome is a digital platform through which audiences can visualize and understand the coronavirus pandemic from a variety of perspectives. So what it aims to do is center the inequalities that the pandemic makes visible. So it really thinks about visibility and visualizing in two different ways. So the gaps between humanities, social sciences, and natural sciences are hard to bridge. And this means that pandemics are often studied without considering their many interconnected histories. Visualizing the virus connects insights from different disciplines to create a collective digital space for exactly such a convergence. The project takes a unique approach to understanding viruses. So we use visualizing as a verb to mobilize a method. Because if you think about it, to visualize is really the first revolutionary step towards action in a world where much of life and its politics is invisible. So visualizing the virus teaches us to look differently. The digital architecture of the platform invites the visitor to navigate clusters of connection. I'll show you in a moment what I mean by that. One can explore links between quotidian lived experience, pathologies, the natural sciences, and sociocultural critique in more or less the same place. So it provides a visitor not just with a dynamic archive, but spaces of reflection on the scales of the crisis and our current sort of infrastructural inequalities. So visualizing the virus is particularly committed to making visible the stories and connections that are not otherwise so visible. So the digital project was set up in the first place to go beyond media narratives around COVID-19 and center facts and reflections between science and society from communities who are made invisible. It aims to provide a granular intersectional picture of the pandemic as it evolves. And we're working in close collaboration with various partners, including the University of Global Health Equity Rwanda, and various other partners. One of them also includes the Global Social Responses to COVID-19 Web Archive. So I'll tell you a little bit about this web archive. There we are. So the Global Social Responses to COVID-19 Web Archive contains a broad range of websites related to COVID-19 that are maintained by residents of Africa, East Asia, Eastern Europe, Russia, and other territories of the former Soviet Union, Latin America and the Caribbean, the Middle East and North Africa, Oceania, and South and Southeast Asia. So it really tries to cover a very global perspective. So efforts have been made to archive websites produced by underrepresented ethnicities and stateless groups in all parts of the world. So broadly speaking, the collection focuses on social responses to the COVID-19 crisis as represented in local news, NGOs, art, blogs, and social media, as well as sort of popular movements rather than national news and national government initiatives, though there are some exceptions to this rule. The collection is stewarded by 29 curators that include Ivy Plus. This is the Ivy Plus Libraries Confederation, their partners, and other libraries across the United States and Europe. So we're trying to work with them to set up and with Princeton and some other funding grants, which we hope will come through. So we're trying to set up a series of part-time research curatorships and fellowships for early career scholars to work with us to create and curate content and to invite scholars who are working in the field and activists to weigh in on some of the things that that are in the archive. So we're still in the very early stages of the project, but I can try to explain a little bit how we envision the layout and digital infrastructure or architecture of the project. So what you see here is a mock-up, and it's not what it's actually going to look like. It's just something that we have for the moment, but it's a useful way for me to actually just show you how something like this can work. So we have what you see here is what we're calling a cluster. So it's a theme of different kinds of contributions that are either text or video or audio contributions. As well, the texts are all very short. They're about 500, 800 words, and they're meant to be even when we ask somebody who has written in depth about something, we ask them to write a short text that makes the topic accessible to a wide variety of readers. And so the little circles you see are the contributions, and where I can't click on it right now, but in real life, eventually you'll be able to click on one of the contributions, and that will give you the contribution. But each so each cluster is a themed section, and then within each contribution there are various tags. So for example, something on COVID-19 and surveillance in Japan may also be tagged with something like lungs or smartphones or in different kinds of like surveillance patterns. And these form mega clusters. So for example, if you click on lungs, you'll get a variety of different things from different countries and perspectives. So it really provides a way of seeing things differently and kind of weighing different inequalities and ways of seeing. So I can give you a sense of what kind of clusters we will have or what kind of themes. And before I say that, I should say that some of the clusters will already, like we're asking for contributions based on a cluster that we have in mind, but very often we'll get a lot of contributions and then form a cluster depending on what we get. So we have a cluster, for example, on COVID-19 and racial inequalities, which will include a range of reflections from different parts of the world. So critical race theorists have described how an epidemic of metabolic diseases such as diabetes was produced by the industrial food system before the pandemic. So these diseases, which disproportionately impact communities of color, make people susceptible to COVID-19 complications. So in writing about pre-pandemic inequalities in medicine and the food system, Anthony Ryan Hatch notes that racism transforms as it seeks to profit from our bodies. And so the color of COVID becomes apparent with the racial data tracker project in the United States, Hatch also writes about this and says, when we measure the effects of racism, we're remembering and documenting intergenerational patterns of violence enacted on the bodies of racism's victims. So in a sense, clusters such as COVID-19 and racial inequality not only give us a window into what's happening right now, but they also reflect on kind of longer histories of racism and not just medicine, but society and art as well. So other clusters are include, but are not limited to things like COVID-19 and food security, which shows how the invisible supply chains of food and labor are affected in a pandemic and affect the most vulnerable communities. So we have a cluster on indigenous pandemic perspectives, which makes visible different aspects of the pandemic on indigenous communities in the Americas, Australasia, and elsewhere. A cluster on vaccine imperialism delves into geopolitics and capitalism. COVID surveillance explores the untold ways in which visual mapping of the movement of the virus can become a larger visual mapping of one's habits, interactions, homes, even. So just trying to move on from this slide. Yeah. So the website will launch at the end of June so this year. So we were supposed to launch earlier, but given the scale of the current crisis in India, we've decided to move the launch to later. And because I think we also want this to be a space of reflection and action and to think about the geopolitical state of things at the moment. So I think it's also helpful to be sensitive to the fact that as it's important to reflect on these things, it's also important to actually pool our resources and help in any way that we can at the moment. So we're launching a little bit later, but we're going to grow for 2 years. And then, so it's conceived not as a static repository or archive, but one that's in becoming. And we will continue to add material to it over the next 2 years. And then after that, it becomes Everything is open source and available, and it becomes something that's accessible to researchers for years to come. And the idea for the project is also that it reaches a broad audience of scholars, students, activists, and general readers and thinkers. Beyond the virtual, we're also mounting a series of workshops, teaching modules and so on to build on our methods and research. This is all to say that we're very much still looking for, you know, sort of contributions, collaborators, funding. It's a project in its early stages, very much in making. So we would really love to hear from all of you. And we can talk more about connections to other speakers on the panel and so on soon. Thank you.
Thanks, Shreya, for a great talk. And what feels a vital resource for what will be undoubtedly one of a significant period of time. And I think, you know, it's good to feel that something somewhere this is being archived and it's going to be made into something that's accessible at a public level. Stella, I wondered if we could talk a little bit about what you raised in your paper. I mean, in a way, there's so much I want to ask, really, but how do we begin? I want to talk about, your work as a poet and how that has informed your activism and where that takes you as a thinker. Maybe begin with that. It'd be really interesting to hear what you say about.
Right. So I live in a repressive dictatorship where we have a militant octogenarian who's been in power for 35 years. And he claims to have won elections in January of this year. This means that he's not open to criticism or critique or even questioning. A lot of dissenters and dissident voices and people who question or interrogate government practice have been punished and penalized. I was arrested and charged twice because of poetry that's quite heavily critical of Yoweri Museveni. I use sexual metaphors. I used genitalia. I use sexual processes. I refer to him as a pair of buttocks and equate him to shit and call for activists to offer him enema. I use that sort of language because the language of diplomacy, the language of civility and respectability, the regime doesn't hear or listen to anymore. So I use poetry and I draw from tradition of radical rudeness that was employed in colonial times in my country to fight against colonial masters. And many people who used this were men. So the fact that I'm a woman and a feminist troubles a lot of people. Why is a woman questioning? And so I think that poetry is one of the last few resources, the creative arts, cartoons, making a mockery of the president. Cartoonists have been arrested and imprisoned. Graffiti makers have been arrested and imprisoned. A man was arrested last month for having an effigy and beating the effigy in the streets. So even creative voices are arrested, charged. I was sentenced to 18 months because I dared to question and critique. And I think part of the problem is that people of privilege, people of education, people with resources tend to work for the government to further entrench its repressive, oppressive policies and programs. Poetry for me offers a creative outlet which cannot be stopped by prison. When I was in prison, I released a book of poems, which was quite, it was an undoing to the regime because they cannot handcuff verses or rhyme or stanzas. In court, although we lost the first level court and I was convicted, we kept calling for alternative interpretations of metaphors, of abstract concepts that are captured creatively by creatives and creators of alternative knowledge, right? And the courts are deaf to that. I think that part of the success of alternative modes of voicing or coloring or archiving, even collating dissent in repressive regimes is we demand for particular registers, we demand for hard work of interpretation. We can lay claim of a poetic justice, for example, or the freedoms that are given to us by the artistic creation. So as a poet, that's what I do. I have written poetry around COVID-19 that almost got me into trouble again, because I think it was quite scandalous for our country that a woman was arrested and sentenced for 18 months just because she wrote a single poem. The second poem, which I've been charged twice for offensive communication through poems and posts on Facebook, each time offending the president. The second time I used the birthing processes of Esiteri, and Esiteri happens to be the mother of the name of the mother of the late president, but my name Stella could also have emanated from Esiteri. So just playing around with language where one can do nothing else. And often my poetries are accompanied with cartoons. So for me, the two media, the two artistic media that I'm closest to are poetry and cartoons.
And Shreya, in terms of your research and your archiving, following Stella's points there, in terms of the visualizations that you've charted or mapped, has there been similar occasions where you've seen instances of resistance to, let's say, the more surveillance-like or common images of the virus and how it's kind of been controlled and state-controlled? Can you say something about
that? Yeah. Absolutely. I think it's been a very important part of it as well. And so just as an example, we have a cluster on COVID-19 and protest in Hong Kong. And this was an exhibition that happened in situ, but they're worried that they can't really have an afterlife of the exhibition in Hong Kong itself. And so we're featuring that with a kind of with a short essay about resistance and what it means to be in a political regime that doesn't allow you to express yourself. But I think the other aspect of this is, as Stella was saying, Stella, I have a question for you about your poems as well. But and hope we can be in touch. But from India, for example, we have quite a lot of cartoons, political cartoons that center around not just the pandemic, but the handling of the pandemic by the government, the kind of the priorities of the government on handling the pandemic. And also a cluster on fake news and what it means to propagate false narratives around the pandemic and how that is politically motivated as well. So I think this has been, and most of the entries there are by artists and activists and also some communities.
Great. I wanted to also ask Stella, you've done so much work in terms of activism, and you mentioned some of your work in sort of medical work in terms of gaining reproductive rights for women or access to sort of menstrual products and so on. I wondered if you could say a little bit about that and that work that you've undertaken and where that stands now in relation to the pandemic, and has those efforts, have they been hampered through this period of time, and or have they shifted, or where has your attention moved to? And maybe it'd be great to hear something about that.
Right, so thank you, Chris, but also brilliant presentation from Shreya. I think to answer you, Chris, I'll first hail one of the things I wish we had in Uganda that I see evidently in Shreya's visualizing or digitalizing this COVID-19 archive. The campaign you talk about, which was raised, I did it really as a protest activity to say to a president who promises sanitary pads to girls who are menstruating during campaign season, and he asks the parents to give him his vote so he'll provide this when he gets back into power. And after he's sworn into the presidency, he reneges on this promise, and he's not courageous enough to do it in person. He sends his wife, who's the first lady, she's addressed as Mama Janetty, the matriarch of the nation. But Mama Janetty tells blatant lies and says, we don't have money in our reservoirs to provide sanitary pads to girls. And out of outrage that menstrual blood of women, poor women, was being used so shamelessly, so misogynistically, I gathered, I had an online but also physical campaign collecting funds. Part of the problem is when I was arrested and accused, and that sanitary pad campaign was criminalized and set up as a danger to state sovereignty, because it was assumed I'm an LGBTIQ activist also. It was assumed that I was getting money, the pink dollars, and therefore the sanitary pads we were distributing would make young girls lesbian, like the myth was created, and it gained a lot of momentum that very many conservative Ugandans, who are the majority because of religion and culture, who needed the sanitary pads, became very fearful because of homophobia. Anyway, the campaign was had a huge life on social media. That's how we organized, that is how we created messages, that is how we created awareness. The problem is when I was arrested and interrogations were done, the government closed down our records, our pictures, our archive, and beautiful pictures of young girls in rural schools receiving sanitary pads and the joy of learning about menstrual health, all that archive, we don't have it, right? Apart from what remained on laptops that were never stolen, or cameras belonging to journalists who photographed that. And so the importance of digitalizing the archive, particularly in repressive societies where our government shut down the entire internet for 5 days during campaigns, right? Facebook is still shut. We still don't have access. People's entire internet life can be taken away if they are deemed to be too hostile as opposition activists. And so, to respond to you, but also to highlight the importance of the project that Sharia is doing. So while it's academic, it's also very comradery, and we salute you for offering this to us, particularly in COVID-19 times. And I think what would be interesting is the sort of stories or clusters you create around the repressive deployment of COVID-19. To penalize, to punish, to other, to segregate. Right now we have mandatory vaccinations for teachers in Uganda because schools have reopened after 1 year and 6 months of school closures, and teachers went on to new lives and they don't want to forcefully take a vaccine, which again, we are very suspicious of as a nation, because we have the AstraZeneca, which was rejected by very many other countries because of blood clots. And so
I think Stella may have frozen there mid-sentence. Should we wait a second? In which case, I feel like we are a bit pushing time here. So unfortunately, I'm going to draw a line there momentarily in any case and move on to Isabel, if I may. It's a shame. But okay, Isabel.
We can circle back afterwards as well, so that's fine.
Yeah. Isabel, hi, Chris. You can start your paper. Thank you so much.
Let me just share my presentation. Is this working? Can you see?
Yes, it's coming through.
So now you can see the first slide of my presentation, and maybe also me, and you can hear me.
I want to thank Chris McCormack of Art Monthly and all those at Paul Mellon Foundation for the invitation here and for support for my research and writing in the past. Today, I'm going to be thinking about how COVID has highlighted inequality of care across the UK in relation to academic work that I'm undertaking. Before beginning, I wanted to ask the attendees today what they remember of 2019. It was only 2 years ago, two calendar years ago. It was the last time that many of us lived in countries that were COVID-free, travelled extensively or internationally, that engaged culturally and saw family and friends freely. It was the last year that many of us was a time before bereavement. But in many ways, it seems like yesterday. The date is significant to my presentation today in that it was the date that, or it was the year that abortion was made legal in Northern Ireland. Only a year prior to this, in 2018, abortion was made legal in the country where I am from, that's the Republic of Ireland. And it remains difficult to articulate the pressures of this non-availability on my young life and how it and subsequent campaigns to overturn it and repeal its legislation have informed my thinking, my research, and my political convictions. Today's talk is in many ways about the impact of borders on bodies and of civil rights. And I've been asked, because of my current research, which attempts to map, chart, and analyze the works of artists, filmmakers in Northern Ireland from 1968 to the current day. The period marks the beginning of a civil rights movement in Northern Ireland, which coexisted alongside and interconnected with mutually informative international civil rights campaigns. This campaign for equality for Catholics in Northern Ireland led to the prolonged period of conflict, which is often referred to as the Troubles from 1969 to 1998 and its long aftermath. This same period is also coeval with the graduation and flourishing of film and video into the critical and academic discourses of modern and contemporary art, with moving image evolving and graduating as a kind of porous and highly political medium. The picturing of Northern Ireland from the vantage point of its citizens and their international creative counterparts and allies aligns with developments in handheld and DIY technologies and different efforts to vocalize and to draw attention to inequality in the state. I want to underline for this talk that I do not speak as or for Northern Irish women or citizens who have been impacted by the topics discussed today. Instead, I propose that the films I'll talk about present a historical chorus of voices in a vastly important, if under-resourced, archive of audiovisual material that testifies to a citizenry living outside or beyond the protection of a state apparatus, providing us as viewers textured and complex examples of feminist, socialist, and intersectional thought, and of solidarity, autonomy, pragmatism, and resilience in action. My opening slide, the one you see now, is a still from a work by an artist called Mairead McLean called A Line Was Drawn, and it's from 2019. And in her words, in it, she explores how our world is structured through the creation of borders and boundaries limiting movement, thinking, questioning, and agency. An integral part of the forming, imposing, and maintaining of these delineations is the control over the narratives around them. I use this slide in lieu of a map and to highlight the human activity of line drawing in border making. As Northern Ireland marked the centenary of its existence as a state this Monday past, the island of Ireland was partitioned on the 3rd of May 1921, dividing 6 counties in the northeast from 26 counties in the south and west, containing a Protestant majority and Catholic minority. Partition followed 4 centuries of the colonization of Ireland, beginning with the plantations in the late 16th century. On one side of this line, Ireland was to become a free state, now a republic, and on the other side of this line, the 6 counties were to be governed by Westminster under the Parliament of Northern Ireland, now the Assembly. Skip forward through a turbulent century of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, and what stands out is the overwhelming evidence of the inequality of bodies felt by bodies in Northern Ireland compared to counterparts in England, Wales, and Scotland, and of the brutality of competing modernities within the UK. And no year has this been more exaggerated than the year we've just faced. Statistically, incomes are the lowest in Northern Ireland, are the lowest in the UK. NHS patients suffer significantly longer hospital waiting lists. Suicide rates are disproportionately high and higher than their English counterparts, than victims' counterparts. And there exist different policies and resourcing for physical and mental health in Northern Ireland than the rest of the UK. The resources to tend to one's own body differ. And this is true in process of gender recognition, abortion, and various LGBTQ plus rights. Crucial legal processes and health services are often unaligned with those in the rest of the UK and also with the Republic. Abortion is one service that highlights the extent of the inequality. Until 2019, it had been illegal in Northern Ireland since the British Offences Against the Person Act of 1861. This was later upheld under the Criminal Justice Act under the Parliament of Northern Ireland in 1945. For reference, it had been made legal in England, Wales and Scotland in 1967. More recently, in Northern Ireland, during an extraordinary sequence of events coinciding with a temporary suspension of the devolved executive and assembly in Stormont, led by the usually staunchly anti-abortion party, the DUP, this abortion law was overturned as part of the Northern Ireland Bill. During a period of political deadlock came a new clause 10 to the bill that was tabled by Stella Creasy, alerted and informed by activists in and from Northern Ireland. Particularly members of the London Irish Abortion Rights Campaign Group. And here I want to thank Jane Wells for her conversations informing me about the intricacies of this process and the energy and efforts of both herself and counterpart campaigners in ensuring this policy change. I think Jane is one of the listeners today. The new amendment under the Northern Ireland Bill obliged UK ministers to comply with their human rights obligation in Northern Ireland, which had been publicly condemned in 2008 by two public UN reports, one by the Committee on Torture, which found abortion laws in Northern Ireland presented grave and systematic violations of rights. However, the situation still remains unresolved. There is still poor and unequal provision of abortion in Northern Ireland, and many of these services have been paused during the pandemic. Women's reproductive rights have long been a source of grief for people in Ireland and Northern Ireland. It has also played a key role in the history of artist film in Northern Ireland. The slide here, the next slide, shows two stills from a work by Margo Harkins, a feature length work by Margo Harkins called Hushabye Baby from 1989. A feature length drama, it showed the experience of a young Catholic teenage woman called Goretti who gets pregnant by a boyfriend and who is then interned. And she has to face various degrees of isolation and social stigma and a series of difficult decisions around her pregnancy. Hushabye Baby was mainly funded by Channel 4 under the Workshop Declaration provision of the early 1980s with additional funding from the BFI and the Arts Council Ireland. And she was also given support in kind and technical equipment from RTE, who are the state broadcaster in the South, in the Republic. Support from Channel 4 had begun when she co-founded the Derry Film and Video Workshop with other filmmakers and activists, Anne Crilly, who was director of the documentary Mother Ireland, amongst other works, and Tricia Ziff, who had worked with the Photography Cooperative and Community Darkroom Camerawork Derry. Hushabye Baby came out of Harkin's interest in the first abortion referendum in the Republic of Ireland in 1983. Harkin has talked about how she looked south a lot, and this is a quote that she from a talk that she did in 2019 at Docs Ireland. She said, "We were connected to Britain, but our allegiances were with a lot of Irish filmmakers and playwrights around then, Cathal Black, Bob Quinn, Brian Friel. So we were referencing all sorts of things, and the 1983 abortion referendum was so horrific. Families were falling out over it, and I wanted to make this gentle intervention. I didn't want it to be a polemic film, but one that would describe what it was like to be 15 in Ireland with its laws at that time. And there were two big cases which convulsed the island. Anne Lovett was found dead in a field in Granard, having given birth to a baby beside in a grotto. And Joanne Hayes was accused of stabbing a baby 28 times. The country was full of secrets. But Joanne Hayes was another cause celeb in that time in Ireland for the women's movement because of how she was treated by the state. So my film was not directly about those cases, but it was influenced by them. And there's several former references to those incidents within the film. Harkin's research and working practice speaks to a dual axis, an axis of production where, like her, many seminal artist filmmakers were funded by organisations in the UK in the absence of a Northern Ireland Film Board or other supportive public institutions, while at the same time there was an axis of critical conversation and solidarity between women and activists north and south of the border, for whom similar punitive threats existed in relation to their reproductive rights. Sometimes these axes jarred, The censorship and restrictions to broadcast of these productions were frequent, and Derry Film and Video Workshop were particularly suffered from various broadcasting bans in the late 80s and early 1990s. Like other films produced in the 1980s, this is another slide from Hush by Baby, and quite famously Sinead O'Connor is one of the actors in it. This is a production still from Mother Ireland, which was directed by Anne Crilly, another member of the Derry Film Video Workshop, which was completed in 1988 and first broadcast after significant edits in 1991. And these are stills from Maeve, directed by Pat Murphy. Like other films produced in the 1980s, and here I include stills of Anne Crilly's Mother Ireland and made by Pat Murphy, it signals the many ways that pregnant people, among others, gay people, transgender people, have had to negotiate different circumstances to claim the right to the health of one's own body. In all of these three works I mentioned, there is an exposition of a real and complicated negotiation of subjectivity and citizenry within the units of both family and state. And each detail, the various results that come of that reckoning, often risking social exclusion, punitive access, punitive action, or exile. So back to the present again, and to conclude, it's just over 1 year since Parliament voted to ensure that women and pregnant people in Northern Ireland have access to abortion. This is still not the case. My second last slide is a timeline of the present, details of how the universal provision of abortion in Northern Ireland has been blocked even in the last year. You'll see highlight we await court proceedings where the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission are taking Secretary's dormant executive and Department of Health to the High Court around commissioning abortion services in Northern Ireland. I can go back to that slide later. But I just want to finish on this screen grab of an organization called Alliance for Choice, who are very much active in demanding that abortion is available to women across Northern Ireland now. This petition is live. You can go to the website and find out more about their campaigns and get involved. And I would just urge listeners, readers interested, to continue to engage with the news as it unfolds. I'm just gonna quote a little from this screen grab from the Alliance for Choice. It's an organization that was set up in 1996 to give voice to the tens of thousands of women who have traveled across the Irish Sea from Northern Ireland over the past decades. They describe how, and I quote from the website, "The current impasse in abortion access for women, girls and pregnant people impacts especially on those who are already marginalized, including people with disabilities, those in violent relationships, migrant women and LGBTQ plus people. COVID-19 has compounded these discriminations. Throughout the coronavirus pandemic, women and girls have been forced to travel to England to access abortion against public health advice to stay at home. Two women attempted suicide after flights were cancelled and they were unable to travel. This must end here. The North is now." And that's where I'll end. Thank you.
Many thanks, Isabel, and incredibly moving material. If we could move on to Ariane, and then we'll continue the conversation.
Well, I'll start sharing my screen. This is not to write. Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank everyone at the Paul Mellon Centre for organising this talk, and Chris McCormack for the invitation. I'm truly honoured to be speaking today in such great company. So while the question central to today's event, I thought at first seemed to be pointing towards a more biopolitical lens through which to view art and pandemics, I found this approach was perhaps not the most suited to the current political situation in Thailand, where power is so outrageously exercised by the current military-backed government. So instead, I would like to look at the statecraft narratives that you mentioned in terms of hegemony and the political dynamics surrounding the pandemic and how art might respond to them. So COVID-19 has affected each country differently, but for the most part, the pandemic has highlighted underlying structural problems, and time until now has mostly been spared. There were rather few cases and few deaths, although the situation is currently taking a turn for the worse at the moment. But for the past year, the COVID crisis has clearly illustrated the ways in which power, and more specifically hegemony, functions. And it has brought to light several illnesses that have plagued the country since decades, namely a repressive, paternalistic leadership style coupled with a nationalism and moralistic finger-pointing and victim-blaming culture or rhetoric that is currently being also encouraged by the current prime minister and several people in power. So this is to say that this was never a safe space, only the illusion of one, which is a rhetoric that the military government has been employing since decades, that a military government will bring stability to the country and safety. But the response to COVID-19, in my opinion, has clearly proven the contrary. So as you may know, there have been massive protests in Thailand since last year. And the protests especially gained momentum after a successful period of lockdown. And successful here should really be in inverted commas, because while the number of cases effectively went down, a vast chunk of the population did not receive proper aid or financial compensation. And so although the protests weren't the direct results of the pandemic, I believe that, and they stemmed more from the frustration about lack of real democracy in Thailand or human rights abuses, I really believe that the tumbling economy, which resulted from the poor handling of the COVID-19 crisis, certainly fueled and added to this climate of discontent. So what about art, then, you might ask? So art functions in this political setting and is caught up with hegemony. So in the past, some artistic practices in Thailand were perhaps in the service of hegemony, but in the last few years, we've seen a lot of artists largely supporting the protest movement, and in the past year, taking on key roles within the protests themselves, which I will delve into further along the way. And again, artists also have not been specifically addressing the COVID crisis, but simply the COVID is just another illustration of how art, how power works in Thailand, but doesn't necessarily have any effect on the relationship between art and politics. But nonetheless, artists have been carrying out counter-hegemonic practices in the past year, which take aim at the same hegemony that is behind this poor COVID response. So I would like to, this is an image that was taken in January of 2020. So it was just a few days before the first COVID case was reported in Thailand. And Thailand was the first country outside of China to have reported cases. It says, the writing in Thai is an acronym for Punam Ngo Rao Cha Dai Gan Mot, which means our leader is stupid and therefore we shall all die from it. And that at the time had to do with the air pollution crisis, and Bangkok was covered in smog. But I feel that it's also quite relevant to the current pandemic. So I would like to jump a little bit ahead coming back to the present and talk about how the pandemic has been managed. And for instance, a month ago, Puong Thong Pakawan, professor, an associate professor of political science at Chulalongkorn University, posted on Facebook that the government's success in containing the first COVID wave, which garnered praise from the WHO, came from the military style of suppressive management, imposing restrictions, curfews, and lockdown. Nothing that requires much planning or understanding of the crisis. But once they have to do some proactive management or devise a strategy planning for the long term, this government has failed us. And I would like also to show you, this is an image that was taken just last week of Thai professor of traditional Thai dance who was performing a sort of ritual ceremony or spiritual ceremony in front of the Three Kings statue in Chiang Mai, demanding the release of political prisoners that have been detained since the end of last year. And she received a visit in a few days later from the military to at her home. And this is at a time when really the people in power should really be tackling the pandemic, but you can see where priorities are lying. So I think that similarly to what Stella has been saying earlier, COVID-19 has been used as a pretense to criminalize political dissent. And so while Thailand was the first country to report cases outside of China, not much was done between January and March from last year, but nightly figures of the government would come on the news and threaten to use the emergency decree to curb dissent. And after the first lockdown was eased and while no new cases were being reported in weeks, the government still kept prolonging the emergency decree, which is still in use today, even as legal experts said that the existing Disease Control Act was amply sufficient to maintain a normal situation. And also the rhetoric employed by the prime minister and several members of government, but also many of their political supporters on social media, there has been really an othering of the sick, especially when they are conveniently for them migrant workers or Thai low income earners. The sick are treated as if they were perpetrators, not victims, and they're blamed for propagating the virus, even labeled as anti-patriotic. So this kind of nationalism and moralism is not new in Thailand, and migrant workers and lower income segments of the population do not receive fair treatment or benefit from, or they do not benefit from any safe spaces in normal time. And in pandemic times, they are even more at risk. On top of this, we also see, this is for instance, an image of a quarantine site that was specifically for migrant workers. So the other quarantine sites did not look like this at all. And also on top of this, we also see a kind of paternalism that is visible in particularly in access to medical supplies, medicine, and currently importantly vaccines. So in last year, we saw some politicians hoarding masks and distributing to their constituents as a kind of bargaining chip for popularity. And what we're talking about here are national supplies paid for by taxpayers' monies probably. And access should be a right, not something that to be magnanimously gifted. So some perhaps would also make the argument, about the royal family donating medical supplies to hospitals at a time when they are facing harsh criticism and their role is being questioned. But of course, this cannot be discussed openly in Thailand, as for instance, a former leader of an opposition party was charged with lèse majesté law, which includes harsh punishments for raising questions about the role of a company largely owned by the king that is central to the vaccine rollout. So do I still have time? Or should
we're
I maybe...
Time. Yeah, so maybe we could...
Yes, just sort of start to conclude. So we've seen, so artists, unlike in other countries in Europe, for instance, where we've seen movements of artists asking from their government for COVID measures to be adapted to problems that artists are facing. Here in Thailand, clearly the focus has been on the protests and on counter-hegemonic practices. So we've seen the resurgence of the figure of the artist as an organizer. So not only providing visual material, but also playing a key role in organizing protests. And also, for instance, here is an image of artists as they were about to be arrested. And these were a group that were involved in the mapping of a protest village. So a village that was set up in front of government house that had united several protesters coming from different places and that were linked to different causes, but that were joined together in front of the government house. And this is as they were about to be arrested. We've also seen a shedding or a blurring of artists' identities and protesters' identities with a lot of dark matter, as Gregory Chalette would call them, which is the memes and images being disseminated online without anyone really taking ownership of them, which is different from a lot of artists who would make exhibitions that had politics as subject matter that would exhibit in their under their own names in galleries, etc., so as to also further their careers. Yes, and also, but now I think in the past year we've been talking a lot about how whether we should or not keep playing within the hegemony's arena or institutions, or whether we should exit and create our own. So this is an open letter by artists that had participated in the Bangkok Art Biennale, which is sponsored by one of the patrons or the sponsors, backers of the military as well. But this and this open letter itself has also garnered criticism, because people were then asking why would you take part in the first place? And it was also rather a teethless letter that did not really. I mean, artists did not say they would pull out or anything. And so, as we are entering probably another lockdown, we could also be asking the question of, since the formal art world and its institutions have now adapted to the new normal, what will happen to the in the case of protest-based practices and these counter-hegemonic practices in Thailand, and what happens after the protest dies down because of COVID? Yes, sorry, this was a little bit long, maybe.
All right, and that was perfect. Thank you for delivering that paper. It was really interesting to hear your perspective and to see what was going on in Thailand. Isabel, if I could ask you to come back too. If we can get any questions from the audience, please do post in the Q&A. Isabel, I think it's genuinely shocking, some of the material that you raise in your paper, I suppose, being here in London and so on. So many interesting questions, not least on a personal level. I was interested in how, well, particularly these artists that you refer to and the careers that they went on to have. What was the reception of their work in the time of their making?
I think it's fair to say that sort of various broadcast bands had significant impact on many of those filmmakers. And also, I mean, it's a constellation of situations, a constellation of creative forces versus difficult situations. So Margot Harkin is still an active filmmaker, and she's currently researching and making work about women and babies' homes in Ireland, which is an ongoing investigation into the catastrophe of and the human rights brutality of these homes that were set up in Ireland for young women who were pregnant and they had their babies there. Many of the babies were given away for adoption, and others died under suspicious circumstances. The investigation is ongoing. So she's making work on that at the moment. She owns her own production. She runs her own production company. She does a lot of, work fundraising to make the work. She had a lot of supporters, like other, that Channel 4 workshop movement was incredible in the early 1980s, really got behind film cooperatives, Derry, but also another one in Belfast, as well as other, collectives in the UK, always prioritizing platforming voices that were less heard. So it was a training ground, provision of some core funding, startup funding, and also some technical equipment. So Anne Crilly and Margot Harkin both continue to make work, although the banning of Mother Ireland, I think, was really damaging to Anne Crilly's kind of ongoing career as a filmmaker. Both I don't speak for her, but from what I've interpreted and learned, just very difficult as a filmmaker to go through that. And that in itself, the broadcasting ban and the stipulations around it from 1988 to 1991 is fascinating. And I would encourage anyone who's not aware of it to also look into that. It was the banning of images and voices with Republican sentiment from British airwaves and to kind of staggering degrees. But So that really impacted the making of work, although, yeah, Pat Murphy's still active, Margot Harkin's still active, Anne Crilly's still vocal. And I suppose one thing, you know, that's been a kind of interesting through line across the four talks, I meant to say in the beginning of mine, it's a privilege to be, you know, in such company as the other researchers and poets and artists and academics. But one thing that's a priority now, I think, is the archiving and historicization of this material. And this comes back to something that Stella said about the digitization of the archive. It's something that Shree is undertaking. It's something that Ariane is doing in practice. And finding kind of safe spaces for that historic material, which is vital to understanding various histories.
I should also point out, in case no, if anyone's missed that, the link to the petition is in the chat room, so do have a look. Ariane, I wondered, you mentioned, or at least in some of the notes I read of yours, you mentioned something of a royal vaccine, and I wondered if you could say something about what that was. I was interested in. Yeah.
Well, it's a little bit delicate, especially considering that this talk is being recorded and will then be uploaded online. So I've been warned by several people to be careful when I speak about this. But it's essentially, it's the reason why Thanathorn Dungnungwanke, who's the former leader of an opposition party, is being charged with lèse majesté because he has questioned. So the Thai government has signed a deal with, I think the laboratory formulating AstraZeneca, so that they will, let's read back from the article, so that they will basically import or distribute this, the AstraZeneca vaccine through this Thai company, of which the major shareholder is the king. And Thanathorn Dungnungwanke, this politician, has asked whether this company is really the best suited company to distribute the vaccine, because it's not a company that has any particular experience in doing this. And therefore, because there are strict lèse majesté laws in Thailand, you cannot defame the monarchy, although this has been vastly misused and misinterpreted to quash dissent and to really get rid of political opponents and political activists. At the moment, many political activists are still in jail awaiting trial due to les majesté charges. And so, the AstraZeneca is now also in Thailand being dubbed the royal vaccine because it is distributed through the king-owned company. And therefore, some people as Thanathorn have been asking whether this was actually appropriate and whether the vaccine was just simply something that was that should be of free access and not something to be distributed or to be viewed as a gift or as a donation in a kind of very feudalistic mentality or system. Yes.
If I could maybe ask everybody to open up their cameras and we could maybe have more of an open discussion at this point. That would be nice. See everyone again. I wondered if anyone had any further thoughts from the group about any of the papers that have been presented so far.
Chris, I wonder whether I could just dive in and just something that had got me thinking as I was listening to all the presentations. And again, it's like a privilege to hear the thoughts from, you know, many different places and perspectives. But I was thinking you were all talking about different media through which these ideas are disseminated and presented, and ideas are articulated, and often thinking, like Isabel, you were talking about TV workshops and broadcast media being used, and Shreya obviously thinking about the digital as a space of collective archiving, and Stella social and Ariane talking about social media and imagery. And I was thinking how this will have an impact on the spaces of display of this kind of material when we do archive it, when we do curate it, and when we do historicize it. And it seems that, you know, there's such incredible pressure at the moment on institutions, and particularly the institutions connected to the art world, museums and galleries, whether you can imagine, you know, radical new forms of exhibition makings and display that will have to come out of this moment to account for and to historicize and sort of revisualize this material. So I just wondered whether you had any thoughts about how there might be some pressure to change on the way in which we display images and other forms of art making and practice.
Just from a kind of local perspective, I think there's, you know, questions around language. This is something that Stella talked about, but language and classification of work, understanding that, you know, border lines are drawn and then they're redrawn, and what we do with national collections when particular areas are no longer. I think this is something, from my understanding, that Tate Britain is looking at in terms of collections of Irish work. What do they do with those works when they were under British rule? They are no longer. How are those classified? So they're kind of interesting. Questions is the classification within organizations. And I think just from my perspective, and it's something that's going on a lot in the larger institutions that have resources, but this question of like where the work is and what's collected. So in work that manifests, as so many of the presentations have, in this crossover between art and activism, the work sometimes sits in the correspondences and the campaigns and the social media campaigns. Again, I don't know if Jane, we've still got Jane Wells here on, but she was this person, somebody I've spoken to a lot and was last night again about her interactions and interactions between her and her campaigners with Stella Creasy, this MP, and you know, that started on social media. So the digital archive, there's a lot of work and thought to go into it. And I think this question of where is the work in practices like these that have political intent is a question that we constantly need to repose ourselves and one another.
Definitely. And obviously interesting in the context of framing this conversation and from the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art and the questions we're having about, you know, what that signifies as well. So thank you for those thoughts.
If I may, I again, drawing from Ariane's point about the intersection between artists and activists and how sometimes there's a clear split, sometimes there's none. I think in the COVID-19 moment, especially when artists are working or creating knowledge that is not necessarily valued as art for curation, I find many times that some of the things we are doing, resisting through art, have been declassified. So the idea of classification and declassification and what is valued as knowledge or worthy of curation, many times I would want to see an archive of all the protest materials that are utilized. I also have had students who've wanted to study my poetry of resistance, and the university has said to them, this is not academic material. And the gatekeepers of what's curatable, what is theory, what is theorizable, what we can learn from, many times, I'm saying something without knowing the language to say it. But do you know what I mean? That I think part of what digitizing does, especially when it's done as an activist moment in the academy, in the museum, in the exhibition, in the digital world, is to say, we shall even include this among the things that are worthy of celebration, of historicizing, of keeping for the next generation. Because sometimes when you're looking for theory, we may not find it in classical music, but we might find it in ghetto street rhythms. And so Yeah, curation is also about creating boundaries and about attaching particular value judgments about the material that's being curated. And I think a lot of it is very subjective, but I think the COVID-19 moment allows us to bash these boundaries and borders and to rethink what is worthy of curation, what is worthy of entering the archive. And so for me, digitization then becomes important because it's a huge space. In terms of COVID-19 being a virus that spreads through the air, I think how we curate and how we approach the museum, if it's going to be a space of infection and transmission and passing on of germs and even possible death will be interesting. And I think the last bit about archiving artistic moments like these, when emotions such as grief and pain and suffering and disease and burial and not necessarily the celebration, but the other emotions that are not very positive, it would be good to capture them, because I think it's been languages like psychology and psychiatry and maybe Bible medicine that have been able to capture the mind, and the artistic expressions of people grieving, a world grieving, would be beautiful to capture and keep for posterity. So curate the grief and the trauma and the deaths and the not knowing that. I'd love somebody to be able to analyze what's happening in India currently and how we deal with that in terms of accessing it 20 years from today will be important.
I think just to speak to that point, the temporal is also quite important in this process of kind of digitization and archiving at this point, but also thinking about how institutions can perhaps follow suit to some degree, but also the fact that there is, I think, a time to collect and a time to reflect, and how as projects, as institutions and so on, how we can find that in between space where, you know, because I think sometimes it's just when you are grieving, you should have the time to grieve, you know, and I think that's quite important to think about as well, in terms of how we can create space, different kinds of spaces when we're thinking about what stays for future moments. And I think the other question that Isabel talked about in terms of national collections versus kind of global collections and connections, I think as well, is really something that I find dealing with more and more, in terms of the fact that, you know, just how do you reconcile very, very local events with the fact that something that's very local is implicated in something that's national, very often, you know, sort of modes of resistance against a national government and so on. But this is then also implicated in larger chains of geopolitical relations. And how to, in some sense, think about all of them at the same time. So this multi-scalarity, I think, is, I find really helpful.
Yeah, and there's some work in like picking the sort of national paradigm as a collection model from the museum, like or freeing the museum of that kind of sort of nationalist thinking, and actually, you know, attending to minorities, attending to localities, attending to these, you know, the chorus is a noun that's come up, I think, amongst all of us, but yeah.
I think it's quite funny, because I really came to this talk already in my head apologizing for bringing such a local or localized point of view, and then finally finding so many connections with the other presentations, and that was just such a beautiful moment after a year in local isolation. But also regarding maybe archiving and digitizing, also in terms of artistic practices that are at the intersection of politics, also a lot of the focus in the past has been on the visual components and also of the protest, and not so much on the idea of the protest itself or the more the project-based histories, and I think personally I would like to focus on trying to keep those perhaps not so much in collections, but at least keep them alive and going through COVID, and which makes those projects impossible to realize outside or in public spaces, and how to keep those alive in these times. It's something.
Yes. We have one question from an audience member, Pete Mahoney, who asks, do you feel enough has been done across the industry to prevent closure of art spaces? It's slightly different topic, but I think in light of the effects of the pandemic, numerous spaces have closed due to lack of audiences, finances, money, etc.
I mean, in this country, there seems to be a fairly exaggerated lack of, support across the industry. That's not to say, there are great instances, I think, of organisations who have been able to survive. But I don't think it's high on the conservative agenda to be maintaining cultural work at the moment, which is all the more reason that panels like this and groups coming together to try and brainstorm. I'm sorry to not have a more cohesive answer on that front.
Well, no, it's reflected in the fact that museums aren't open until the 17th of May.
Exactly. Commercial galleries can sell, so they're open early. Museums, in the public interest, that can wait.
But Sharia, I wanted to ask, in a way, the pandemic obviously has exacerbated all the structural issues that underpin much of life beforehand. So instances of racism and so on, and even, all these issues that are embedded in society. In terms of your website, how have you, the ethics and the approach of that, it's a very big question I'm asking perhaps at the end of this conversation. I was interested in knowing a little bit about how you approached the subjective representation of those issues, and how you've gone about that as a strategy. Is there a way you've sort of thought through this subject?
I'm not sure I 100% understand the question, but I think how we understand larger structural issues. I think the idea is that there's multiple levels of what we put on the website. So some of it is kind of, say, an artist's contribution that is a political cartoon or something like that. And then we often invite somebody to write a little piece about it. And I think it's in that, those reflections where you can actually make the connections to already existing longer term structural inequalities and things like that. So to really kind of get to thinking about very specific things in the pandemic, but from different perspectives, if that makes any sense. So that there are ways in which you can create these, create these holes, as it were, to think more broadly about the past and the future, as well as, something that's very rooted in the present. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, and in terms of then how you're fielding or soliciting responses to the website, are you charting that yourself? Are you kind of inviting people, or is that an open invitation?
Yeah, this is a really good question. So at the moment, it's invitation only, just because we are such a small team, we can't really have an open call. But at the same time, it's also, we are asking, talking to people in spaces like this, talking to people about what the project is, and then asking for people to write to us with, if they're interested in contributing. But the plan is that as we grow, to have research fellows or research curators who then are able to reach a larger, from different parts of the world as well, who are then able to reach larger larger numbers of smaller communities, if that makes sense. But for the moment, there is no open call. But I hope at some point we might have the kind of team strength to have something like that.
Any final thoughts or comments here? And otherwise, I think we can maybe draw a close. But
I just want to say thank you. What an amazing group of contributors. To you, Chris, and to Paul Mellon. Thank you.
Pleasure. It's always lovely to see you, Isabel, I should say, and everybody. Thank you so much for taking part. It's an honor to hear all of your contributions today, as I'm sure everybody here is applauding in the audience, if they could. Silence in the digital world.
Safe in the knowledge we can't hear if they're not.
I know, it's always this moment actually, isn't it, at the end of events where, you know, we know there's a community of people joining us and connecting with us, but you know, we hope you can feel the energy of the discussion and our ideas, and they've come back to us as well through the chat and you know, links that have been sent. But it's been really, I love Shreya's phrase, a time to collect and a time to reflect. And it made me just really think about the importance of spaces to share ideas and thoughts in progress as well. You know, it's like I say, it's sort of not final words, but opening out discussions and, you know, thinking and rethinking. So I just really appreciated listening and being part of that discussion.
Well, thank you so much for the invitation. And it was really great to hear everyone's thoughts and comments from different parts of the world.
Yeah, and also to just virtually meet all of you.
Yes.
Thank you.
And I guess at this moment we say, you know, as well, thank you so much to our panelists and to Chris for bringing us all together, but also to the audience for joining us. But we hope that you'll come back tomorrow, because we have another event at the same time. And again, that will give us a further space in which to carry on these discussions and think about them through a different lens of wearing out. But we hope that you will have the energy to join us again tomorrow for the discussion. So we'll gather tomorrow at 1 o'clock.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.